Welcome to Slash Forward. In this episode, we're going to explore a mystery about repressed memories, or possibly about supernatural hauntings. We won't know at first, although the 1982 Australian mystery horror film, Next of Kin, leaves no doubt with its ending. So subscribe to the channel and come along as we try to figure out who done or is done it. Let's get to it. We open on a bruised and bloodied woman at a petrol station. Through voiceover, we hear that old Linda here is a proud recent recipient of a significant inheritance. So why so sad? Let's find out. We then find ourselves cruising down the road in better times, recklessly zipping around through the amber fields of her hometown. She and Nickel arrive at the local diner from the opening, where Nickel is relinquished to the care of his father, Harry. She settles in and is served some coffee as Harry offers his condolences over the recent loss of her mother, recounting charming anecdotes about how she used to come to the diner and just sit and stare out the window. How wistful. Linda arrives at the estate she now owns right as a rainstorm begins to roll in, so she enlists the help of Lance in bringing in the wash, a task he is barely able to do, and they're not quite fast enough as they fail to bring it to completion before the clouds open up. Inside, Linda sorts through some boxes of old collectibles and memories, before heading up to the dusty attic where she becomes nostalgic about mommy's favorite volleyball. She's then approached by caretaker Connie, who helps her get the window closed and warns her to watch out for the power lines. As they proceed downstairs together, we learn that the estate is actually an active nursing home and has been for many years. So her inheriting it has also put her on the tracks of her future career path. And honestly, it's kinda nice to have that locked down. Outside, Zeus attempts to prevent this caravan from reaching the home, requiring the occupants to risk full saturation just to get to the house. As they manage their way around the landscaping, Linda tries to get Lance back inside so he doesn't catch a chill, but the dang door is all jammed up. The overall scene creates an immaturish impression for their new guests, the Ryans. When they eventually get in, it's suggested they all spend the night due to the rain. Baby Ryan considers this as he soaks in the view of Linda taking the stairs. She heads up to dry her hair while reading her mother's old diary, which makes reference to a strange wanderer lurking in the halls of the house, which coincides with Linda observing a man's silhouette outside. This brief occurrence triggers something for her as she is relegated to spending a restless night reliving the nightmares of her childhood. But the morning sun washes away all bad thoughts, and we awake to the normal bustle of the nursing home. Linda gets herself ready to head out on her daily errands while Lance gets ready for his morning salt, but finds the tub was already occupied. Rude! And while the scrubs are busy fishing out the slippery corpse, Linda flips her hair about and engages in some travel flirting with Mr. Ryan, behaving here like a young road warrior. She arrives at her destination and meets with Barney, an absolute unit. They have a packed day of indolence planned, starting with a float in the crystal brown waters of the local river. This is followed with a quaint visit to Linda's mom's gravesite, and then a carefree run through a field of wildflowers. Linda gets a bit too wrapped up in the whimsy of this and soon finds herself alone, deep within the woods. She thinks she spots Barney in the distance, but then he assaults her from behind. He decides to humor her momentarily by going to inspect the sighting, but he finds nothing. As they drive off, she expresses the distinct feeling she's been getting that she's not welcomed by the community, after leaving for years with no intervening contact. To try to help assuage these feelings, he invites her to come to a party that evening, which may put her back in the good graces of her peers. The inanity of their entire day is brought into sharp focus when she arrives back at her estate and learns of the unexpected death earlier that day. She goes to check on how Lance is doing, and Dr. Barton confirms that the cause of death for the other patient was heart-related. In the course of the conversation, she seeks out more details about the death of her mother, and he tells her she was suffering from significant stress and anxiety. All of these recent pieces of information have caused her to begin thinking in terms of selling off the property. Linda then gets dressed for the party, but Carol shows up to escort them, so she decides to forego the festivities and instead walks Barney to the car while Carol reams out the gearbox.
Aw, bloody geez! Pop me a secret, Japan?
On her way back in, she makes note of a watcher in the window. She then relieves Connie and Dr. Barton for the evening and has a disorienting walk back to her room. She spends a little time catching up on her correspondence before being disrupted by her kitty, who leaves her to go chase a shadow. Stupid kitty. As she glances over the books, she notices something very odd.
Dr. R.B. Rita.
But that's not all.
R.B. Rita.
Now wait, where have I heard that?
Dr. R.B.
Ah, of course. But before the significance of these entries is revealed to us, the power goes out, meaning that somewhere in the house right now, someone's life support has shut off. Linda finds the hand torch and makes the rounds to ensure everyone's doing okay, but then gets distracted by Puss Puss's incessant mewling.
Meow. Hey, Puss Puss.
She confirms the corpse is still dead and is happy to get a little alone time with it. But then she finds Miss Peterson there, staring into the abyss of her own mortality. Eventually, she gets to the breaker box and flips the comically large switch. Just in time, too, because Barney was just calling. He's grown tired of partying and, well, he's feeling awfully horny, so he'd like to come over. But then the call is interrupted when someone else picks up the line and breathes heavily into it. Linda goes off to find out who's intruding on her privacy, but finds no one at the other end of the line. Other than old Puss Puss, of course. On the way back, she hears the sound of someone drawing a bath. She goes to investigate and finds that some jagoff thought it'd be funny to try and ruin the subfloor. Luckily, she's able to solve that problem with a few mere towels. That night, she finds herself again dreaming of herself in the hallways of the house as a child, while her dead tenant floats outside. She wakes up to Barney's brawny arms, and he does what he can to help put her at ease, utilizing a unique upper torso technique that he learned from a buddy. The next morning, he can't get out of there fast enough, which suits Linda's preferences just fine. Downstairs, we see this as a shopping day for the home, and the residents are ushered onto the shuttle. Despite it being a mandatory trip, Lance refuses to dress for public and instead spends his morning fishing a sweet beret out of the front fountain. So his shopping's done anyway. She tucks him back in and asks if he was around before her Aunt Rita died, but he whispers that she's not dead. Linda then goes to greet Carol, who appears to arrive and then tear right on out of there. Finding this odd, she goes to find Connie and tell her about the strange happenings she's been experiencing, but answers are not forthcoming. So she tries to go relay this to Barney, who can't reach Carol by phone but thinks little of it. After that, she's off to ask Dr. Barton more details about Rita, due to Lance indicating she didn't die. The doctor claims this is likely because she was moved to a different nursing home before she died, and he suggests it would be ideal for her to just go ahead and forget all about that nasty business. But when she gets home, she sees movement in her window again and is determined to get to the bottom of it. Unfortunately, she doesn't find anyone in her room, and Connie insists the house is empty except for them and Lance. When she returns to her room, she finds the diary open to a page in which her mother wrote about being unable to live with a terrible memory that haunts her. As she reads further, it's indicated that this terrible memory originated from an event 20 years prior. So Linda dives into the archives and pores over accounts of strange noises in the night, taps left running, and an ancient evil present in the house. She reads and gets progressively greasier, until it's revealed that she herself had found a dead dude in the tub when she was very young. And it wasn't just the one dude, many tenants were found drowned. She goes to the office to access the records and peeps a scene that makes it look like Connie and Dr. Barton are plotting against her. In an abundance of care, she quietly pulls the records for the parties named in her mother's diary. None of them list death resulting from excessive bathing, and all are signed off on by Dr. Barton. Little bitch! She circles around behind them to get a look at the house corpse again and finds some curious marks about the neck and shoulders. When they find her, she rushes off into the forest, eventually arriving at the bingo hall. She presents as disheveled and confused as she seeks out Barney's assistance. Then they all sit around and watch as she struggles to open the door, confirming that they likely do hate her. Outside, she struggles to maintain her composure, but Barney manages to bring her down. They eventually make it back to the estate, where Linda requests the Barnster take a peek at the documents in the office to confirm that she's not crazy. She, of course, elects to wait outside. Nearby, as the cherubs yeet toward the heavens, the stream turns suspiciously red. Afraid this may be a hallucination, she pulls back the ivy and is relieved by the confirmation that there's an actual dead body swimming in the base of the fountain. Of course, this doesn't bode well for Barn, so she runs inside, only to find her grand protector now deceased, as he is launched out of a wheelchair into her face. Thinking quick, she rushes upstairs to save Lance by pushing him out the window. She holds the door as footsteps pound down the hallway, and then sneaks out to her own room where she locks the door from the inside, but only discovers too late that she's not alone. Sitting in her chair, wearing her mother's jacket, is Ms. Ryan, revealed to be her crazy Aunt Rita, not only alive, but also super pissed about being kept from her precious estate. She spends a little time soothing Linda as she quietly unlocks the door, and then Mr. Ryan appears, looking and acting as crazy as can be. They play a little game of footsie grabby, and he menaces her in a truly psychotic fashion. After toying with her a bit, he makes like he's gonna do her right in front of his mommy, but he plays too much and allows Linda to get the upper hand. Linda breaks free and locks herself in the bathroom, where she finds the remaining witnesses to the horrors that have befallen them. While trying to decide what to do, Rita makes a fatal error.
I can see you.
And she pays dearly for it. Linda then runs past them, hops into her truck, and goes ripping into town. She arrives at the diner where Nickel sleeps, apparently. She rushes in and they lock up and barricade themselves. The phone is not functional for some reason, so they're left to sit and wait. She works through her trauma with the help of some sugar cubes, a project she finishes right as Mr. Ryan busts through the front window, absolutely pissed about his mommy's eyeball. They mostly stand there as he continues to push his way in. Nickel lets off a couple of ineffectual shots that do little more than reveal several pathways to death, as some live wires others dance hypnotically near a forming puddle of petrol. But since this isn't Final Destination, Linda decides to leave nothing to chance, and cleanly removes his head with the shotgun. Then they drive off into the sunrise as Nichols' livelihood, and possible home, go up in flames behind them. I have a website set up where you can support the channel through donations or merch. I'd like to take a moment to give a huge thanks to my donors, memorialized in the Hall of Headshots. This was an odd one. I think it's considered an Australian classic. I'm not sure if you picked up on this from my narration, but it doesn't really have a connected and well thought out plot. Even so, it is suspenseful, has a few cool ideas I haven't seen elsewhere, and is shot really well. It's not just a basic low budget movie. If you enjoyed the video, I'd love for you to become a part of the channel by subscribing. Thanks for watching.